Hey, everybody, what is going on? Gordon Attard here from the Network Marketing Duplication Radio. And in this episode, we have a guest speaker. So it's going to be interesting to see their perspective on how they're building and how you can build your network marketing online, why building online. And we've got Julie Ciardi. So Julie is a mom and a former Fortune 500 marketing VP turned multi-passionate entrepreneur. She is also the host of Ignite Your Side Hustle podcast. We're going to get into the nitty-gritty right after this. If you're like me, we all know that network marketing is a real asset, and it is on the rise. But we have an issue. How do entrepreneurs like us, who didn't rely on their family members and friends to join us, who want to grow and scale a profitable home business, as we see the power and leverage of network marketing to maximize our efforts using the internet to auto-recruit quality prospects and create extra incomes with a duplication system, yet still have time to enjoy the rest of our lives? This has long been the question of many hopeful entrepreneurs, and this podcast will give you the answers. My name is Gordon Attard, and you are listening to Network Marketing Duplication Radio. Awesome. So welcome to you guys. It's exciting to dedicate some time and get into and listening or watching this podcast. For those who want to watch this, you can go on my YouTube channel. You just type Gordon Attard and you're going to find this and the other episodes as well. For those who are listening on the podcast, welcome to you. If this is your first time, we majorly talk about network marketing when it comes to you building it online. Why online? And today we have a very special guest with us, Julie Ciardi, that we're going to talk with her about her experience and also how she became a multi-passionate entrepreneur. I like this word. So Julie, how are you doing today?
I am so good, Gordon. It is such a pleasure to be here. And thank you so much for creating this podcast. I know that we'll get into it, but podcasts was what gave me the motivation, the inspiration, and the tools really to be able to actually leave that Fortune 100 job. So I love what you're doing. Thank you so much for bringing it to the world.
Wow, it's a pleasure. It's a pleasure to have you. And in fact, I wanted to start with this. For those who don't know you, Julie, how did you manage to decide to leave that six-figure income corporate job, okay, to be a multi-passionate entrepreneur? And what advice can you give?
Yes, well, it's interesting because when I was first starting off, in my career, there was no online entrepreneurial journeys to go on. I mean, the only entrepreneurs that I knew back then when I was, leaving college and needing to go on that, what's my job going to be in career? It was people that owned, the local car auto body shop or the restaurant or, the hair salon. And that's not what I wanted to do. I didn't know there were other options. So I went to the traditional path. And, got my master's in business, started to work for really, I say Fortune 500, but it's really a Fortune 100 company in the world, and started to rise up the ladder kind of in a traditional way, and became a vice president of marketing there. And it's interesting because I never loved it, Gordon. I never loved it, but the company was ahead of its time at the time. And actually I mostly worked from home, which is funny because, that has kind of been the holy grail for people, entrepreneurs wanting to leave the day job so they can work from home. Now everybody's working from home, if you're listening to this real time with the pandemic. But I have to say, I was able to do that starting back in 2002. I was working from home and I would travel. I had to travel the world and all of those things. But other than that, I was home. I was not in an office. So here I am, a mom of three. I've got this balance. I have this incredible salary that is, bonuses. It's hard to walk away from that, especially when you build your lifestyle around the money coming in, right? And my husband, God bless him, he is a police officer. I was the primary breadwinner. So a lot of the weight of our lifestyle and what we wanted was on my shoulders. But I got to tell you, Gordon, I got to this probably the highest level in the company I was going to get to. And I looked around and I was thinking, I'm not happy. I have the money. I have the house. We've got the vacations. I'm not happy. I don't love what I'm doing. And I always felt like I was missing something more impactful. And I got to be honest with you, I felt very, very guilty admitting that. Because most people would look and say, how dare you, right? Like, you've got this job, you've got this money, like, how dare you? But it was a real eye-opening moment when, you know, whether you believe in God, you know, the universe, sometimes things happen to say, you know what, listen to the thing that's nudging at your heart, because we're trying to tell you you're supposed to be doing something different. Believe it or not, after 18 years of pretty much working from home, the company changed its workforce strategy and brought everyone back into an office, which meant a 2-hour one-way commute. So 4 hours a day in the car for me. That was a big wake up, and decided that was it. I needed to do my own thing. And that was really where it started. I was like, you know what? Now's the time. I don't want to be commuting 4 hours a day. I have 3 beautiful children. I want a certain lifestyle. And that's when I approached my husband and said, we got to do something different here. And for any of your listeners who are kind of in that position, here is my big piece of advice on this. I remember our accountant said to us, look, it's not about how much money you make. It's about how much money you keep. And I said, you know what, let's sell that. We have this huge house. Like, for what? You know, we have got one life, and I'm not going to tie myself to a huge home for what if I'm not happy. And so we decided to sell our house, downsize, change up our lifestyle a bit, at least temporarily, while I was able to then leave that big job and build my own businesses. And network marketing was a big piece of that. So that's a little bit of the backstory. But the key here for anyone listening is that you have choice, you have options. You have options. You just have to take a look, and you have to decide, am I willing to take a little step back to propel myself forward in a different direction?
Love it. Love it. Love it. I love the fact that you mentioned that, first of all, you took the courage. That's a highlight that I wanted to mention here, because some people, you know, are maybe they're listening in here and listening to this podcast or other episodes, that they tend to be on the fence, right? They tend to be on the fence, and it's like they're waiting for something to happen that pushes them to be much more courageous to take the next step or to change, you know, something changes. And one of my favorite quotes is, nothing changes until you change. So until you decide. And this is why one of the things that I wanted to highlight. And also, you mentioned the word impactful. You were looking for something that you had the house, you had the good job and everything, but you were looking to impact more people. So that's how it all started. I love it. I love it, honestly. So you got into, let's get back into the same track. You were looking for a side hustle at that time. And how did you know about network marketing? Was it something that you knew before? Or was it something that you encountered along the way, or because you were looking for a side hustle?
All right, it's so funny, Gordon, and your listeners are going to love this, because I have found that people tend to approach people that they think need money to join network marketing. And I'm here to tell you, no, money I did not need, right? I had this big job. I was making plenty of money. Money was not my motivator. And the funny thing is that years and years ago, I was exposed to network marketing more so because a friend, you know, would introduce me to someone, and it was a mom, and she had, you know, can she come into your house and do a party? You know, she's selling, you know, home decor and like cookware and stuff. And I'm like, okay. Now my daughter's 17 and she was a baby at the time. So this is how long ago it was, right? And you'll find this funny, Gordon. So I watch this woman come into my house, and she's lugging all the products in, and she's getting everything set up. And here's what I thought. And I knew she was a mom, and this is like an evening, you know, during the week. I'm like, oh, that poor woman. I really was like, oh, that poor woman, like, she has to do this, right? So I had this like idea in my mind that you only did network marketing if like you were desperate, which obviously is so far from the truth. But that was my first look at it. And I was like, oh, I would never want to do that, right? I had a total misperception. So flash forward you know, 15 years from then. And here I am not happy in this corporate job. Right. And I don't know what I'm looking for. I got to tell you, I still can remember like where I was writing like ideas. I'm like, what could I do? I still didn't even understand the possibilities in the online space, network marketing or other. I really didn't know it yet. When you're in corporate, you don't even know that this other world exists. Like I had no idea. It was like a secret passageway or something I discovered once I saw all these people making money online, doing all these crazy things, all these amazing things. So here I am, not happy. I'm making the list. I have no idea what I want to do. Network marketing was not on that list, by the way. Not even a thought in my mind. And a friend of mine literally, you know, approached me around product. It was just around product. And it was actually jewelry. Okay. And she approached me and she said, "You're so stylish and fashionable. Like, I think you would love this. We've got these amazing, amazing jewelry." I'm like, okay. So I bought the jewelry. It came in the mail. I was like, wow, this is gorgeous. The packaging is beautiful. The whole experience was amazing. And I said, I think I'm going to need more of whatever this is because I'm loving it. And she said, "You know what you should do, Julie? You should totally like sell this stuff." And I'm like, "Oh no, I don't sell." She's like, "No, I'm telling you, you're good at marketing. You're good. You wear the product so well, like you should do it." Mm-hmm. I was bored. I was lacking creativity. I was doing marketing, but for like a tech company. I don't love tech, right? So okay. I do love style and fashion and all the things. So I'm sharing this because I want your listeners to really remember that motivation is very different for people. It is not all about the money. So don't always lead with additional income stream. It could be that creativity, fun, you know, being able to learn new skills. And because I used to joke with my husband, like, "I'm pretty good on social media. I wish I could make money on social media." I actually said that, like, 7-8 years ago. Little did I know that that actually was a thing. And network marketing, what it did for me, Gordon, it was my first toe dip in to like the waters of entrepreneurship. And I was like, whoa, okay, there's something to be had here. And so while that wasn't the thing that actually helped me leave my day job, it helped me stay out of going back to my day job because I ended up doing some of my own income streams in addition to network marketing. But here's the thing. I will never not have a network marketing income stream now. To me, it is like, as we plan out various income streams, and I think I wish 10 years ago someone told me that you should always be, you know, having multiple income streams. I didn't know that was possible. I thought you had like, you know, your 401k and your check from your company. Like those were your two like income streams, maybe some investments, you know? And I had no idea. And so now like I will never not have a network marketing income stream. But the big thing, and I think you agree with this, is that I treated network marketing differently than what I was being taught by the company that I joined. Right. And I had a pretty strong reaction to how I was being taught to start my business in network marketing, how to grow it. And I was like, this feels really icky and not like in alignment with how I want to do my business. And I'm sure we can kind of unravel that, but I think you agree as well, right?
Right on. In fact, this is where it gets interesting. Why, in fact, this is a part question as well. Why, Julie, why do you think that those who are listening to this or watching this should take a look, okay, at doing, especially now, I mean, where the world is right now and where we're going, where it's heading, why they should, even if not fully at this stage, but what they need to do is to think about moving their business and maybe fully in the next few months online. Why they should go that route instead of doing it the old ways or just the old ways? Because I know that some people want to mix because they love to meet people face to face, etc., etc. But what are your thoughts about this? Why they should move their network marketing business and build it online?
Oh, it's, to me, it's imperative. I mean, if we didn't learn that this year, I mean, it's, I mean, your business will go under if it's 100% in person, right? You have to have the online capability. Now, that being said, you can mix it, right? I mean, I came from corporate marketing. I mean, in our marketing strategy, you would have in-person events and you would have online marketing and you'd have email marketing. I mean, there's all different things that you can be doing, right? You as a, you know, entrepreneur need to have multiple paths to do your marketing. So in person is just one element of how you do marketing to run your business. And here's the other really cool thing. For anyone that's like kind of been very much mostly an in-person type event network marketer, I want you to actually infuse the online with the in-person in this way. Let's say you run an event and you've got 20 people that come to your event and you're getting to know them. Make sure that you have brought them into your online space, whether that is wherever you do, you know, your content. Is it YouTube? Is it Instagram? Is it a Facebook group? Whatever it is, make sure you bring them into your online space, because guess what? Someone's going to come to your event. They may not be ready to buy anything right then. They may not be ready for the opportunity then. We so go to the one and done. Like it's like, oh, I met the person. It didn't work. Moving on. No, or I'll keep calling them after and see if they're interested. We have to nurture people. And nurture is kind of a word we used in corporate, but the idea was that we're going to continue to give them valuable information, valuable content, valuable touches online, so that we're actually moving them from kind of a cold meet at an event to a warm, like, potential lead to become either a business partner or a customer. And so really consider how you actually infuse your online strategy into your in-person as well. And then of course we know in-person, you know, at any given point in time could come to a grinding halt when a virus should hit or whatever that may be. But here's the other really important thing. And I know you probably teach this too. We're looking for our ideal customers. We're looking for our ideal business partners, right? We want to get specific, right? We want to get specific. There is no better place to do that than online. I like to joke that we're living in a time better than any other to be building these businesses online. Think about like when it was solely in person. I mean, 15 years ago, it was. There, you know, what did people do? Go door to door and knock on doors and, you know, try to book conference rooms and in hotels. And we are so blessed. And so if you're at all nervous or you feel like you're not, you don't know what you're doing on social media and you're not really sure how to bring it online, you're in the right place. You're obviously listening to Gordon's podcast. That's huge. There's so many resources out there, free and paid. But I want you to stop just depending on your network marketing company's training to how you grow your business, because they're amazing and they're teaching you products. They're teaching you their systems. They're teaching you how they want you to grow because they believe that that's going to be the fastest way for their company to grow as well. You've got to take the time to go outside your company and learn online marketing techniques, online marketing strategies, as if you were any other business, right? And I think that is imperative if your goal is to have a sustainable business in network marketing.
I like that you mentioned the word that I always also use, nurturing your prospect, nurturing your next client or potential business partner, because like you said, there's so many tools out there that we both mention when we are on podcasts or on our podcasts. And this is very important for those who want to grow a business, because I always say without a list, you don't have a business. And having like a group or growing your list where you can communicate with someone, like you said, that they're not necessarily joined because you showed them one time, first time, because they are looking for more information, or maybe it wasn't the right time for them to join the first time you showed them. So you have to have a system, okay, that you can communicate with them, that you can put them in front of more information. So that's one thing. And the second thing that I liked also is And we definitely are 100% or more agree with this, is because you need to strive to be a better marketer. Because your competition, I mentioned this because it's truly what it is. Your competition is not someone else in another company, but it's your sponsor, your upline, or your new member in your team, in your downline. Because if you're targeting the same niche, the same people, okay, they are your competition. So you need to be a better marketer, how to put your products or services in front of them. And this is how you can leverage, one way you can leverage the internet that way. So there's many ways how you can do that, especially with funnels. And I know maybe we get into it in just shortly about funnels, if you work with them with funnels. But before we get into that, what are some of your top tips, let's say top tips for creating a personal brand? Because it is important. Mm-hmm. You're an entrepreneur. You, like you said, you're joining a network marketing company, but it's people are going to join you, not the company. So it's very important about that. So what are some tips, Julie, around that? And also, let's start with this. What are some tips that you can give for those who are looking to build their personal brand?
Yeah, and it's so important now more than ever, because customers, potential business builders, people are savvier than they've ever been before. And so what used to work back in 2012 doesn't work anymore. Okay. I say that I'm on a mission. I don't know if you guys say the same thing where you are, but like, I'm on this mission to end the "hey girl" messages in the messenger. It's like, people, you know, the companies are telling you to make these list of 100 and send these like super, super long, you know, curated words to say, and putting them into a message to someone you haven't spoken to in 20 years. I'm sorry. We're not doing that. Guess what? It may have worked in 2012. In 2020, about to be 2021, it doesn't work, because the consumer, the average person, is so tired of feeling like they're being prospected, of seeing these messages come up. It has to be different. You have got to be a human being that is trying to create value, period. Right. And when you lead with like your company's name, and it's your, you know, you become basically, what I see is I see people being employees of a company, of a network marketing company. Do not be an employee of your network marketing company. Have it be you that is choosing products and a business opportunity that you love, and you're making sure that you're bringing that to market yourself. Now, it requires you to really get clear on your message. And so what I like to say, I like to boil a personal brand down to this. Yes, you can pick pretty colors and you know, pick out your colors for your brand, and maybe you have some fonts. Not great. That's like a teeny tiny piece of having a personal brand, right? Mm-hmm. Having a personal brand to me means really three things. What is your story? Not your company's story. People lead with the company story all the time. What is your story? What is your story? You know, what is going to be relatable to your person that you're trying to connect with, right? So your story, really making sure that you're sharing that, you know, in a relatable way on social media, in your emails, right? In video, whatever your platform is, making sure that people know, because people want to work with people or buy from people that they know, love, and trust. It used to be know, like, and trust, but like is too lukewarm of a word now. Like, people want to be with people they know, love, and trust. And you and your story and that relatability is imperative. The second big one is, who on earth are you trying to talk to? Because if you are trying to reach everybody, you're reaching nobody. We've heard people say that all the time, but here's where it really comes down to. You cannot create a compelling message in the marketplace if you're lukewarm. If you're like, I help women become empowered to live their best life. Okay, that is like as vanilla as it comes. If instead it was, I help women battle, you know, thyroid issues so that they can regain energy and happiness in their life, boom, now that is way, way deeper, right? And you can go and find women that are, like, if your products help women balance their hormones or whatever, like, you can go find your exact person, right? And if you've battled with it yourself and these products have helped and this company's been game changing for your own personal story, boom, it starts to like play out, right? So it's who, what is your story? Who are you targeting? And not just like mom of three living in the suburbs. It's like, no, a woman that is battling with, you know, thyroid issues, right? And you know, like what their fears are, what their, you know, anxieties are, what their desires are, where do they want to be, right? And then the last one is, how does your solution, your offer help them, right? You got to work on the wording on that, right? It's getting really intentional that you're trying to help solve someone's problem, that you're really trying to help your ideal person. So when I think personal brand, I think it's your story. Who specifically are you trying to help? And what is that core message of what are you offering them? When you can dial that in, you never run out of content. You're always wanting to help people and you can always find your people. Because again, the beauty of social media, the beauty of the online space is you can find people that are battling thyroid issues, or you can find people that are whatever the niche is that you're focusing in on. So that is like my top tips.
The story is everything. You said it right, because it is your sales message. So if you most people think that they're gonna go into their favorite company, whatever it is, if it's wellness or jewelry, like you mentioned, or anything, and they're gonna study the ingredients, study the benefits, and this is what is gonna help them sell, instead of becoming a storyteller, because that story is your sales message. As a matter of fact, I'm a big fan of Steve Larsen. I don't know if you follow him on Instagram or social media. He is literally opened my mind up to funnels and why I needed to become a better marketer. And it's funny how one of his courses, actually, he just sold a book. Okay, this is how important, and really, really wanted to highlight this, because of the sales message is a story. He sold a book, okay? Just by sharing a story, and this book, he didn't read it. He didn't know what it was about, okay? He didn't know who is the author, okay? But he sold it. People want the link to purchase the book. That showcases, I think you can find it on YouTube. Just go search the book selling story, something like that. And probably it will show up. And that shows you, like Julie said, highlighting and lead with your story. And then definitely ideal target market. Who's your target market? Definitely is a big one, because you cannot think that your product is for everybody, but you need to find much more clear, have a clear target market. So you solve their problems when it comes to content, because even this, I don't know if you have this question, maybe people ask this question to you as well. What type of content should I create? So let's get into this. If let's say someone is going to use social media, or maybe they're growing a list, what type of, how do you come up with content? Let's put it this way. Simple, yeah. Simple and easy. How do you come up with content? Because some people struggle with this because, like you said, they think that everybody is their market.
Yes, 100%. I mean, the fastest way is to do the work we just said, right? What is your story? Who is your ideal customer? What is the problem you're trying to solve? Really, and the problem. Don't try to be like 1,000 problems. What is the problem, right? Zero in there, then your content creation really flows. But to break down the content piece, you're going to really think about, okay, kind of like you can even make like three columns on a piece of paper. And you're going to put my story, you're going to put my ideal person. I hate to say customer because it could be a business builder too, right? So your ideal person, they could be a customer, they could end up being a business partner with you, whatever that may be. And then I want you to put, you know, the transformation, or, you know, transformation/offer. And you're going to brainstorm different topics. What are the different elements of your story, right? Like I break down like my leap from corporate, like that's one element of my story. I talk about, you know, being a mom and the beauty of being able to, you know, work from home and be a mom and how I did that, right? So I have a bunch of different things that are in my story, right? I have a bunch of different things about my ideal person. I know that she is like struggling massively right now because she's in the day job. She's homeschooling her children. She's, you know, feeling so frustrated, knowing that she wants an out, doesn't know how to get there, doesn't have self-confidence to do it. Like I know her very, very well, right? So I can kind of write down what her thoughts and fears, but what she wants. Like I also can paint the vision of what she wants. I'm kind of brainstorming these things. Same thing on the transformation. Now, here's the key thing. That is going to help you with like some good posts, probably some good emails. But here's where, like, from a content perspective, at least, you know, at this point in time, at the end of 2020, that is really, really, really working. And that is valuable content that helps people to learn, to be educated. Like, I want you to think about your ideal person is like, they don't really know you yet. They don't really know what your company or your products or what you're offering. They don't know much about you. We're going to say they're cold, right? They're cold. You kind of just connected with them and you want to get them all the way across the line to, you know, being a fan, to wanting to learn more from you, to wanting to connect with you, to potentially working with you or buying from you, right? That is a gap that you have to fill. Not your company, not anyone else. I always tell this to my clients, whatever. It is your job. Your main job is to fill that gap. Your main job as a marketer, as a network marketer, whatever, right? Think about it. Marketer is at the end of network marketer, right? You've got to be a marketer, right? It's so important. Your job is to fill that gap. Well, how do you fill that gap? Well, let's say you sell CBD, okay? And this person that's on, you know, over here cold doesn't even know what CBD is. And they're saying, well, isn't that like marijuana? And isn't that illegal? And I don't really know anything about it. And you want them to like join your company? Okay, that is a big gap. How is someone going to join your company that doesn't even know what CBD is yet, right? That is your job. Your job is to create content that educates. I would create content that talks about, you know, what is CBD and getting deeper though. Like, you know, did you know that CBD, you know, can do XYZ, right? Like, or maybe breaking down different components within CBD and why it's the most powerful plant in the, you know, I'm making it up here as I go here. I like CBD. I'm not really selling CBD, but like, I'm just using it as an example that you cannot take someone from cold to joining your team until you are bridging the gap with valuable content that's helping them get there. So it's inspiration, it's educational. It is, you know, being able to talk about like the top three steps for something, you know, being able to create value. I love things that like, you know, I have clients that sell nutritional products that are kind of complicated nutritional products. And they're breaking down like some key ingredients that have really weird names, you know, and they're doing posts and emails like, what the heck is, you know, ashwagandha or whatever the ingredient is, right? And it causes curiosity. Well, what is it? And let's say it's an Instagram post and that's the thing. And I swipe to the left and I start to learn the top three benefits of including this ingredient in my life. I'll be like, oh, wow, I had no idea. That is so much more compelling than buy my shake. It's awesome. It helped, you know what I'm saying? So do the work to know your story, who your ideal customer is and what the transformation is. And then remember that it's your job to create content that helps that ideal person go from cold and not knowing anything about you or your industry or what you're selling and all that to like being a customer or a business partner. And when you put that hat on, you start to find new ideas. I tell my clients, go to Google. If it's your job to bring someone from cold to close and whatever industry that you're in, make sure that you're getting information and you're an expert in that industry outside of your network marketing company, right? So let's say on the CBD example, I would make sure that you are subscribed to newsletters from external third party, you know, experts on CBD, right? I would be making sure like at least once a week I'm going in and I'm Googling latest trends on CBD. That third party information is amazing content. if you just go off of stock photos from your network marketing company, you're going to have a very lukewarm result. If you decide it is my job to be an expert in my industry, to understand what's going on in this industry outside of my network marketing company, and I need to educate and bring people from cold to close, your whole universe opens up in terms of the kind of content you can create. So that's like my big piece of advice.
Fantastic, fantastic. I mean, that's a great way, creative way, how you definitely get content. And content, like you mentioned, you can use it to email it out to your list on social media, or if you have a blog, and so on and so forth. So one other thing we mentioned earlier, I mentioned the word funnels. Is it something that is part of your strategy? Do you use funnels to grow your business? Or
you do.
Fantastic.
I do. I have to be, completely transparent. I'm not using it at this time for my network marketing business, but I'm using it for my other income streams that I have. And that's just another thing. I'm a huge fan of having multiple streams of income outside of network marketing, simply because you are still tied to a company. And I got to tell you guys, this is a real story. I was in a network marketing company, and thank God I was already building my other things at the same time. They changed the compensation plan.
Okay.
And my pay from that company was cut in half. So it was reduced by 50% overnight.
Wow.
Okay. That was a big wake-up call. I've also seen in many different people where a company went under, or a company, with, at least here in the US, we've got like the Federal Trade Commission guidelines, and things are very strict here. And like at any given time, a company could be in trouble because of some rep that didn't do things the right way. You're still tied to a company. So I'm a big fan of making sure that you have multiple streams. That being said, I'm a huge fan. I mean, funnels are incredible. And here's what, again, we just mentioned it. You're going from cold to close. That's what funnels do, but more in an automated way. So an effective funnel is going to be effective when you use some of that content strategy we just talked about, right? If you're dripping, very valuable information that's helping people go from, okay, you were offering something, it seemed pretty cool, I kind of came into your email list or whatever, and now you're giving me content that I'm like, oh wow, I need to learn more about this, right? I need to know more about Gordon. I need to know what he's doing, right? That is the beauty of the funnel, is it takes that cold to close,
right,
and automates it and puts it, on, just repeat for you, which is incredible, right?
Absolutely, absolutely. I love funnels. I mean, when I talk about funnels, it's because it gave me that leverage, number one. And second thing, like you mentioned, someone that is cold, he just listened to an episode, then he started to follow. I can slowly see if it's weeding out if he's the right person to be part of the team or buy the products, et cetera, et cetera. So also we have a similar story, because I love multiple income streams. And in fact, I have plans to do more episodes on that, because although we are in network marketing, yes, we're big fans, like you heard Julie saying multiple times, to create other things. And this is what you bringing your business online. There are affiliates that you can participate and recommend. So again, be open to that side as well. Don't just rely on your company, but by becoming and striving to become a better marketer, it opens more doors for you. And as a matter, to conclude this, and then share with us where they can follow also your podcast, or where they can best get in touch with you. My last question is this. I know that you're a mom. Okay. We mentioned that in the introduction. And for those moms, okay, that are maybe listening to this or watching this, Julie, how can a working mom, right, create a side hustle while working a day job? In this example, okay, much more focused, how they can start building their network marketing business, okay, and they're working as a house engineer. I call them house engineer, which is a mom, right, taking care of the house, and also maybe they have a job. How they can maybe start thinking, listen, I should go for this, I should start doing this. how they can start their side hustle income.
Yeah. Oh, it's so important because, I mean, I did this 2 years. I was still working as a vice president of marketing at a big company while I was building my business on the side. And the business, the first business that I built was not network marketing. It was what I dipped my toe in, but I actually created a physical brick and mortar boutique. So I actually built an actual physical business. And I did that while working full time. So if I can do that, you can start a network marketing business 100% while you are doing all the things as a mom. Here's a couple of recommendations that I have. First and foremost, make sure that you choose a network marketing company that you are in love with the products. Like, they literally excite you. You want to scream it from the rooftops because it's amazing. You love the company culture. You love the business opportunity because maybe it's in an industry that is just like skyrocketing or whatever. If it doesn't excite you, you're not going to put the time in. So make sure that first, because that's going to motivate you. If you're excited about it, you're going to get motivated. And when you're excited, you'll find the time. The second big thing I will say is definitely listen to what Gordon and I are saying about make sure that you are learning. Okay. You got to take the time to learn, and you're going to learn, yes, things within your network marketing company, and you're going to learn things outside of your network marketing company. One of my best business tools I possibly have, and I'm holding it up. If you're on the podcast, I'll describe what it is. It is my Apple earbuds. Okay. These little babies are amazing because when you are making dinner, folding laundry, doing all the things in the house while the kids are off playing, doing their homework, whatever, you can be listening to podcasts. You can be listening to trainings from your company while you're multitasking. We are very good at this. So yeah, these are like,
are the best at this.
Invest in wireless ones because it's the old, then you can do the things. You can be doing the laundry, making the dinner, all the things. Okay, so that is huge. The next thing I would say is you've got a time block, and you've got to, whether it's Sunday or Monday morning, I want you to look at your week, and you're going to block off. If you can't find an hour a day, right, you can find an hour a day. Do you have to adjust some things? Yes. I always say that when you're in the beginning, especially the beginning phases of starting a business, it's a season. You're not going to necessarily stay there forever. So you know what? If you have to give up something else so that you can spend an hour a day on that, maybe it's getting up an hour earlier. Maybe it's staying up an hour later. That is what I did. That is what I still do. And it's powerful. It's powerful. Can it be hard? Yes, but it's how bad do you want it? Right? How bad do you want it? You're going to find the time. So you're going to listen to things while you're multitasking, and you're going to really try to time block and give yourself that permission, because we're not so good at that sometimes. We'll think we'll get guilty, like, oh, I shouldn't be doing this. If someone came to you and said, look, in about a year or two, you could potentially have a six-figure business, a six-figure revenue stream. If you had $8,000, $9,000 a month coming into your bank account every month, would that be worth getting up an hour earlier? Would that be worth staying up an hour later? Most people are going to say, yes, sign me up. Right?
Absolutely. Absolutely. Well, that's it. Basically, thanks for the input, and thanks for being on the podcast. And this brings us to an end. One final question, where they can learn more about you, Julie, where they can follow you. I know that you have a podcast, so that's the time. Yeah.
Yeah, absolutely. So Ignite Your Side Hustle is the podcast. And I just had a book come out that's all about building a personal brand. Awesome. So this is going to be a great resource for people too. You can get it on Amazon. It's called The Standout Breakout Formula. It's got a workbook that goes with it that you can print out. And it's just going to help people to define their personal brand, their content strategy, and how to start leveraging online tools to help grow your business. So I would love for people to check that out. And you can always connect with me on Instagram. It's Julie Ciardi on Instagram. I love messaging with people. So if you love this episode and you have any other questions, just message me. I'd love to hear from you.
Fantastic. So that's it, folks. Thanks once again for you tuning in. And once again, it's been an honor to have you, Julie, on the show. So that's it. So make sure you share this around. Make sure you watch the other episodes as well. If you're watching this on my YouTube channel, make sure you subscribe and hit that thumbs up button and leave a comment, leave a question. What were your takeaways of this episode? We read and we love all your comments as well. Having said that, this is all. This is Gordon Attard signing off for yet another episode from the Network Marketing Duplication Radio. Take care, guys. God bless. And I'll see you on the next one. Bye-bye. Are you on the path of network marketing success in this present day? The reason I'm asking is because it is a question I get asked all the time. Gordon, are you using the power of the internet for your personal network marketing today, and how? Well, I am using modern tactics to grow my personal downline and sell products. You see, the network marketing profession is changing and evolving at a fast, rapid pace. And you probably recognize this fact, and that is why I wanted to show you how instead of just telling you. So I've created this MLM quiz at presentdaydownline.com to help you identify if you are truly on your success path or not. After you've taken the quiz, you will see what was that spark my hunger to quit using the old traditional offline ways that you're so frustrated of, just like I was, and how I'm using modern tactics to build my downline using the internet in this present day. Again, just go on presentdaydownline.com and go take the MLM quiz now.